Hare Krishna, welcome everybody, good evening.
Hare Krishna Guru.
Hare Krishna Govardhan. So welcome again for the Discover Yourself series. So today is the third evening. So last 2 days we discussed, we're discussing this. In the first session we discussed about soul, second session we discussed about God. So today we'll be discussing about Vedas, so three topics. So people are still joining, so I'll just begin with short prayer and then we'll start the discussion. Om Jnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Sarasvade Deve Gauravani Pracharini Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashchatya Deshatarini Vancha Kalpadrubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Eva Cha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Priyadvaita Gadadhar Shiva Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So just to quickly revise what we learned yesterday, we saw, we learned that we can see the hand of God by what we see in this world. By seeing nature, we can try to understand the presence of God. We learned many many proofs, basically A, B, C, D, E, F formula. Wherever you see any art, it means there is an artist. Wherever you see a design, it implies there is a designer. Wherever you see a law, there is a lawmaker. So like this, we saw different proofs of the existence of God. We also saw how many scientists like Einstein, Newton, Kelvin, they also propagate the belief in God, and we saw their statements. One more scientist, he says that for science, God is at the end, and for religion, God is at the beginning. It means that where science ends, religion begins. Because ultimately, all scientific discovery is all scientific research is trying to find out the truth, isn't it? They want to understand. Stephen Hawking wanted to make a formula which can explain everything, but they could not make it because they were trying to make the formula without God in the formula. When you put God in the formula, then equation fits and then everything is perfect. But without God, the equation is incomplete. So the theory of everything could not be completed without God. And Stephen Hawking died also. So without God, all the equations become incomplete. And then we also saw $2 million questions, and we compared universal government and the government of the state. Okay. Now, after yesterday's session, how many of you have firm faith that God must exist? Please type in the chat box if you have firm faith, if you strongly believe now. Okay, so many are raising their hands, okay, and many are commenting in the chat box also. 100% faith. Okay, so I do have faith, okay, firm faith. Thank you. So we should not have any doubt. And in fact, we should be able to give faith to others. We should be able to give faith to others that God exists and nothing is happening by chance. Everything is happening by the will of the Lord. right? Intelligent design. We also discussed about Big Bang and a big brain, and we understood that how Big Bang also we need to put faith. In Big Bang theory, we have to put strong faith because nobody has seen that point from which everything came. But it is reasonable to put faith in a big brain because we see that a brain is working in this world. It is not happening by chance. By seeing the world around, we can have faith in the Supreme God. Okay, Yashwant is telling, I have faith in God. The question is, who created God? Yesterday we answered this. One who created everything, he is God. One who created your God is the Supreme God. You have faith in one God, you are telling, but you are thinking that that God is created by somebody, then that somebody who created him becomes God. You go to somebody who is never created. Such a person is God. Okay. So now the question comes that if God exists, then how can I know him? Is there any way to know him? And if yes, what is the way? So let's try to see today's session. Discover the manual of life, access truth beyond defects. So in this session, we are trying to discuss about, see, in our life, for everything, we need a manual. When you purchase a mobile, you get a manual. You purchase a hard disk, you get a manual. A pen drive, along with the pen drive also manual comes. So everywhere there is manuals required. Otherwise, we will not be able to use the machine properly, and we may break the machine. We may misuse the machine. So that's why manual is given. Similarly, this human body is also a machine. The world is also a machine. And this Vedas are the manuals given to us by the Lord. And when were Vedas written? They are coming from the dawn of creation. Okay. And how to put faith that what Vedas are telling true? Many things which Vedas have said have come true, and science has recently discovered it. For example, Jagdish Chandra Bose, one of the famous Indian scientists, he discovered recently in 19th century that plants have life. Okay. But Vedas long back tell that there are chara and achara. There are living entities who are moving, and there are non-moving living entities. Non-moving living entities include plants and creepers, all those things. So Vedas already tell this. Embryology. Anybody here is a doctor or MBBS student? Yeah. Embryology is the topic of study. Many doctors study that. So, Yashwant is a doctor?
I am a medical student, Prabhu.
Medical student, okay. So, you study this Grace Anatomy?
Yes, Prabhu, we study in the first year.
Yeah, first year you might have studied. You are in which year now?
Now I am final year.
Okay, you are in MMC?
No, Prabhu, I am from Sri Sri College, Bangalore.
Okay, Sri Sri College, Bangalore. Okay. You are from Mysore, right?
My native is Mysore, but I study in Bangalore.
Okay. So, embryology is given in Grace Anatomy, where it says that, okay, after the sperm breaks the egg and how the embryo grows. Every month what happens? That's given, and they have done research, they have seen through the, you can say, scanners and everything, and they have written that book. But Vedas tell about this in the scriptures thousands of years back. The time when there was no scanning machines, there was no microscope, at that time, the sages have written it. In Srimad Bhagavatam, 3rd canto, 32nd chapter, the whole anatomy is given. What happens in 5 days? What happens after 1 month? What happens after 2 months, 3 months, 5 months, 7 months, 9 months? It's all given systematically. So the embryology is also there, part of Vedas. Now cow dung and cow products are very useful. Cow dung is considered to be antiseptic. And in all of your villages, I'm sure that the homes are cleaned by cow dung. Puja room is used, cleaned by cow dung. Isn't it? In front of the home, they put cow dung, because it's antiseptic. And cow urine is also considered to be very, it's called dosha nashaka. and it also has anti-cancerous properties. And it is said that when you do Agnihotra Yajna, that when you burn cow dung and pour ghee into that, it releases oxygen and it purifies the entire atmosphere. So Vedas tell about all this, but science is recently discovering. Ayurveda, yoga, vastu, organic farming, Sanskrit language is considered with the best language for computing. Vimana Shastra, metallurgy, then there is astrology, there is cosmography, astronomy, Vedic mathematics, so many things. So Vedas contain vast category of information, field of knowledge, along with spirituality. Spirituality is the main thing which Vedas give. Along with that, they give all this also. So we'll see six blind men and one wise man story today. Three ways to gain knowledge. Four defects lead to imperfect knowledge. Scientific research, can it offer complete knowledge? And Vedas offer perfect and complete knowledge. So these five topics we'll discuss today. So once in a village, there were six blind men. They could not see. So they came across one creature who was very tall and huge. And each one of them started touching it with their blind eyes, touching it with their hands and trying to find out what is it. So somebody was touching the tusk, somebody was touching the trunk and the legs and the stomach and everything. So they are coming to different conclusion. The person was touching the trunk, he thought it is a snake. It looked smooth like a snake. Person was at the behind touching the tail, he saw it's a rope. Then the top one was touching the ears, he thought it's like a fan. And then person with the tusk, he thought it's like a, sorry, stomach like a brick wall, and then tusk like an arrow, and the leg like a tree trunk. So they're coming to different conclusion. So are their conclusions correct or incorrect? What do you say? Okay, Govardhan is telling
their
that I came across
this. Conclusions are as per their perception.
Okay. Anubhav is telling that their conclusions are as per their perfection, previous experience, correct? Okay,
yes.
Govardhan wants to add something?
They're expressing what they are feeling.
Okay, they're expressing what they're feeling, but whatever they're feeling, is it correct?
No. According to them, they are correct.
According to them, they are correct. But according to you, they are wrong.
Actually, we can see, but they are all blind, right? That's why.
Correct.
No one is correct or wrong, sir, here. They are telling their, as per their perception, those things.
Okay, they are telling as per their perception. See, they are relatively correct, absolutely wrong. What do you say about this? According to their relative perception, they are right. Okay, I think it's like a brick wall. But from absolute point of view, they're incomplete, you can say. Instead of saying wrong, you can say they're, can we say they're incomplete in their knowledge? What do you say? According to their perception,
they're
right.
Blind.
Yeah, because they are blind. Because they are blind, their conclusions are incomplete. They are not complete. There is not absolute. Isn't it?
Yes,
sir. Yeah. Now, if you replace this elephant with God, and people who are trying to search God, to these blind people, some people see God is light. Some people see, you know, God is this human being is God. Some people think this universe is God. Some people think they are God. So the different perceptions come because they are trying to understand God with their own relative perception. But from the absolute point of view, they are incomplete in their knowledge. So if you want to get complete knowledge, you have to ask a person who knows what is an elephant, right? How do you think they can get complete and perfect knowledge about the elephant? This will be answered at the end of the session. Okay, stay till then. So three ways of gaining knowledge. So generally we gain knowledge by three ways. One is pratyaksha pramana, direct sense perception through our eyes and ears. Anumana pramana, theories based on observation or guesswork. Maybe like this, might be like that, like this, maybe, might be. Shabda pramana, hearing from bona fide authority. Okay, so there's three ways of gaining knowledge. So let's see one by one. Pratyaksha pramana means direct sense perception. So Kankar, pratyaksha gives full knowledge. Pratyaksha means seeing. He is seeing, believing. Now here you see a railway track. Are they joining at the end? The track is going like this, but they're meeting at the end, is it? No, right? It's not meeting, but it appears to be meeting. So he is seeing, believing? No. Right? In this case, it is not. Now here, this child is seeing the mirror. One is a convex mirror, another is concave mirror. And he's seeing himself tall and he's seeing himself short. Is he tall or short? It's just an illusion, isn't it? So there's distorted reflections. Is the pencil broken?
No, Guruji.
No. What is it? This is called no. Law of refraction. It appears to be. You ask a child, he'll say, pakka, it is broken. Right? Because he doesn't know the law of refraction. Is there water in this road? Water is there? No. This is called as a mirage. The heat and the wind, it gives an illusion that water is flowing. It's called mirage, marichike. So we cannot acquire complete knowledge using our material senses like eyes, ears, and etc. So there is sight, there is touch through the skin, hearing through the ears, taste through the tongue, and smelling through the nose. So these five senses can get illusion. So we saw about eyes, how the eyes can get illusion. Now, yeah, why we get incomplete knowledge? Because the senses are imperfect. Okay, and we have four defects. So let's see what are the four defects in every human. First is imperfect senses. All our senses are imperfect. Then next, they have a tendency to be illusioned, coming to wrong conclusions. That's called illusion. Tendency to commit mistakes and cheating propensity to hide the mistakes. These are the four defects which every human being have. Imperfect senses. See, our eyes are blind outside the range of 400 to 700 millimicron. So this is the range of visible, this is the range of light actually, waves. But you see, only the visible range, which is violet to red, can be seen by the eyes, which is just a small fraction of the entire wave band. Now the whole information beyond this range is hidden to us. We cannot access it. We cannot see ultraviolet rays. We cannot see infrared rays. So the reality in that ultraviolet region and infrared region is hidden to us. Okay, we cannot see. So our eyesight is limited. Sometimes you see the dogs and cats, they are barking at someone, something which we cannot see, but they can see. And our ears are deaf outside 20 hertz and 20 kilohertz. But the elephants and cats, they can hear infrared sound and they can produce infrared sound. And the bats and dolphins, they can produce ultrasound and they can hear ultrasound. Bats don't have eyes, but still they fly. How? By sound, infrasound, sorry, ultrasound. So that's how they travel. So if senses have limitations, I can use instrument to get more knowledge of the world. Okay, I'll use a telescope. I'll use some hearing device by which I can hear better. But there is a scientist called Eugene Wigner. He says, Even if you photograph stars, eventually you have to take in by our senses what the photo shows. See, if you use a telescope also, still you have to read the information or the photo through the eyes only. So eyes have imperfection, so still the knowledge will be imperfect. Isn't it? Like in medical science or in engineering laboratories, every instrument has got an error factor. It can be a screw gauge, vernier caliper, it can be a lens, an optical device, everything. Even the data transmission, wireless transmission media, that's what error factor. So no matter how much are perfect, the instrument may be, still there is an error factor. Similarly, your eyes and ears have error factors. So still what, how much are perfect machine you use, knowledge is still mixed with errors, faults. Even if amplified, refined by instrument, the knowledge is no more perfect than our imperfect senses. So this is what Eugene Wigner says. So here is another experiment you can do. You eat gulab jamun and then eat orange. The orange will taste sour. It will not taste very good. Orange is sweet, but it tastes sour because you ate sweet before. You eat lemon and then eat orange. The orange will taste sweet. So same orange, but it is appearing sour and then sweet. Why? Because of illusion. Skin. Okay. So you take three waters, one cold water, one normal water, and one hot water. Okay. So you put your hand in hot water for 2 minutes, the hand becomes warm. So you put it in the normal water appears cold. Okay. You take your other hand in the hand, put it in the cold water 2 minutes, and then put it in the normal water will appear warm. So one water is appearing cool for one hand, for another hand is appearing warm. How is it? It's illusion. Tendency to get illusion. I'll show some photos. There are two ways of seeing the photos. You can see two pictures in this. So in this photograph, what do you see? How many of you are able to see a young lady and are able to see an old lady? You can type or you can speak in the chat room.
Two in one, Guru.
You're able to see both, Govardhan?
Yeah, it's a baby girl as well as when we deeply observe, we can see a old lady also.
Okay. But some people in the chat box are saying they are seeing only young lady. Many are seeing only young lady. Only Yashwant Krishna is seeing old lady. Okay. Some are saying
both.
Okay, Yash, you have come before also. You know everything. Yeah, she gets attending second time. Yeah. See, this is a young lady. She's turning like this. This is the nose and this is the chin and the cheek, the neck portion, and she's having a scarf kind of thing. And you want to see the old lady. This is the nose of the old lady. Big nose. And then the lips and the chin. This is the eyes of the old lady. Okay. So, two in one. Is there a triangle here? Is there a triangle here? Okay, many are saying yes, 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 yes. Why everybody saying yes? Everybody's getting illusioned. Actually, it's a white paper with some three circles or sectors. Triangle does not exist. The triangle is an illusion. We are seeing a triangle which does not exist. You are seeing something which does not exist. So this is called as illusion. And in this photo also, you can see two things. One, two old people and two young people. Are you able to see them? Yes?
Yes, Guruji. Yes.
Okay. Purnashree Celsius, Anjali Celsius, Kanwar Celsius. Okay. Everybody singing is Akshay also. So these are two people, you know, singing and dancing. And somebody's coming out of the home here. And if you see this old lady and old man. So two in one. Okay, observe carefully. On laptop, it may be very clear, this one. Is it static or is it moving?
Moving.
Moving.
No, Prabhuji, it's our imagination.
Yes, one request for Yashika, because you already attended before. I think you should just watch. Let others, new people can answer. Okay. Yeah, it is static but appears to be moving, right? Akshay is correct. Purnashree is also correct. Now here there are many circles looking like flowers. Are they static or moving? Same thing as before. Static but appears to be moving. They appear to be rotating a little bit like this, like this, like this. Okay. Now here, focus on the middle dot and move your head a little bit like this and like this. What do you observe? Just a little bit go like this and like this. Eye should be on the dot. What is your observation?
Moving.
Okay, they appear to be rotating like this. So this is illusion. Eyes are getting illusion. All our senses have tendency to get illusion. So because we get illusion, we make mistakes. We come to wrong conclusions. And initially, brain was thought to be like a organ to cool the blood. Just like in a car, they have a radiator, which radiates the heat. So similarly, brain was thought to be like an organ, which cools the body. Because sometimes when you get too much headache, the head becomes hot. Beshak garam ho gaya bolte in Hindi. So brain was thought like that. But later on, they understood hey, it is like a master gland. And the pituitary gland was thought to be like a vestige. Vestige means a useless organ. But now it is considered to be the master gland. Isn't it, Ashwin? Really? Master gland?
It is master gland, yeah.
Yeah, so doctor is verifying. So it is like the most important organ, which produces many, many important hormones required for our body. In science, there is called something called Hubble constant, which is used as a cosmic yardsticks to measure interstellar distances. But because of tendency to get illusion, the Hubble constant has changed 3 times, so it has become Hubble variable. And in science, you'll see the cheating in science, a search for missing link between apes and humans. So you know Darwin's theory, from monkeys came to the humans. And they say that there is something called as Ramapithecus or some in between.
Human evolution.
Human evolution. So they
Dryopithecus, Australopithecus, Ramapithecus, Homo habilis, Homo sapiens, somewhat like this, like human evolution.
Yeah. So they wanted some missing links, right? From monkeys to humans, there should be some intermediate links. But it was proven that they're all cooked up. In 1912, connecting link was made up. But in 1953, it was proven to be a fraud. Human skull was taken and filed to show that it was a connecting link. Right? Hoax proofs of missing link. So filed human joint, ape skull joined, trying to prove evolution of ape man. See this video.
Evolutionists go.
I hope you're able to hear.
So far in this subject that they can even invent very different faces for the same skull.
The three entirely different reconstructions made for the fossil calls in Xanthropus is a famous example showing how persistent evolutionists are in producing these false masks. Another intermediate transitional form fabricated by evolutionists was the Nebraska Man. This was cooked up in 1922 on the basis of a single fossil tooth. The evolutionists did not neglect to give it an ostentatious Latin name, Hesperopithecus Harold Cooka, or to make imaginary drawings related to it. It was soon revealed that the tooth that had been the source of inspiration for Nebraska Man in fact belonged to a wild pig. Many other fossil skulls have been presented as great evidence for evolution failed one by one. Neanderthal Man was advanced as evidence in 1856, dismissed in 1960. Piltdown Man was advanced as evidence in 1912, dismissed in 1953. Zinzanthropus was advanced as evidence in 1959, dismissed in 1960. Ramapithecus was advanced as evidence in 1964, dismissed in 1979.
So many evidences were proposed, but they were all dismissed because of cheating. So we'll discuss about Darwin. Is he going to come? We're going to discuss in detail about Darwin. Coming to Anuman Pramana, theories based on observation. Till now we discussed Pratyaksha. We have four defects: imperfect senses, getting tendency to get illusion, then there is committing mistakes, and cheating propensity. To hide the mistake, we cheat. Let's go to Anuman Pramana, guesswork. Theories based on observation. It may have been like this, or perhaps it was like that. So maybe perhaps that's called as. So Origin of Species by Natural Selection, a book written by Darwin, is an example of Anuman Pramana. Okay. So there is no proof till now for this theory, but it is based on highly speculative, imaginative observations, okay, and conclusions. So Charles Darwin, can somebody read this quote? Somebody can read clearly and slowly. You can unmute and read. Yes, quickly. Yeah. Anjali. Yeah.
Anumana Praman, theory is based on observation. In one of his letters to A.R. Welles, December 22, 1857, Darwin wrote, "I am a firm believer that without speculation, there is no good and original observation. After 5 years' work, I allowed myself to speculate on the subject and drew up some short notes. These I enlarged in 1844 into a sketch of the conclusions which seemed to be, to me, probable. Origin of Species."
Yeah, so this is a book written by Darwin, Origin of Species by Natural Selection. In that he says that I have observed, and based on that I have made some conclusions by imagination. Right, he was traveling once by HMS Beagle, which is a boat ship, and he went to an island. There he saw some birds, some reptiles, some trees, and monkeys and humans, and he saw some similarities. And seeing the similarities, he drew up some connection. Oh, from this, it must be this. Okay, from apes came humans, from reptiles came, from fishes came reptiles, from reptiles came birds. Like this, he drew up some imaginative sketches, which he came back to his home, and then he more and more imagined, speculated, and then made a whole story of evolution. So let's see some of the stories mentioned here. So according to Darwin, one of the first things he says that monkeys evolved into humans. So according to him, about 2 million years back, there are no monkeys. So there are no humans, only monkeys were there. And because monkeys were evolving, they're trying to survive and they evolved. They were using tools and they were using some stones and other things, and eventually they evolved to human beings gradually to survive. But that should be supported by evidence. At Darwin's time, there is no evidence for this. He said in the future, in book he writes actually, I've gone through some of the sections of his books where he writes that in future, the evidences should prove my theory, then it can be accepted. Like that he writes. But what does the evidence say? So those who are researching on fossils, 40,000 years, 1 lakh years, if they go down the earth crust, even up to 2 million years, they are seeing that humans and apes coexisted. But according to Darwin, only apes should be there in the bottommost part. And on the top part, there should be humans. But the observation research contradicts Darwin theory. So human beings and apes simultaneously existed millions of years ago. So see another observation he says, how the polar bear turned into a whale. So he made observation between both. In North America, the black bear was seen swimming for hours with wide open mouth, thus catching like a whale, insects in water. Right? It swims and then it keeps swallowing fishes. Even in so extreme a case as this, if the supply of insects were constant, one condition, supply of insects should be constant, and if better adapted competitors did not already exist in the country, I can see no difficulty in a race of bears by natural selection, more and more aquatic in their structure and habits, with larger and larger mouths, till a creature was produced as monstrous as a whale. 1964 edition, page 184 of Origin of Species. So this is the theory he's writing. Now it requires tremendous faith to believe in such a story. Right? We have in our living time, we have never seen one species turn into another species. But Darwin is telling that how bear transforms into fish. Another story. Why giraffe had long legs? So long-legged giraffes and short-necked giraffes existed together, but short-necked giraffes disappeared because they were very hungry and they couldn't get reach leaves on the trees because down the vegetation was getting over. So there was no food on the ground. So those who could eat the leaves on the trees, they survived. And long-necked giraffes survived. This is why we see only giraffes with long necks today. Okay, if this is the case, okay, then why are cows still existing? Why are the deers existing, the rabbits still surviving? How can they survive? Right? Only giraffe exceptional being. And another question is, giraffes also had to drink water, right? If giraffe had to stretch the neck, then did not they drink water? They have to bend down to drink water. So they can eat from ground also. Right? What about other quadrupeds like the deer? If monkeys have evolved to humans, why are monkeys still surviving in the present day? Right? According to survival of the fittest theory, monkeys should have got extinct. Because human being is more fit to survive. That's why monkeys have evolved into human beings. So these are all contradictory things which Darwin theory has no answer. So that's why many of the scientists, they have rejected Darwin theory and they have come up with some new theory called Neo-Darwinism. Because during Darwin's time, there was no knowledge of DNA or RNA. Now that the knowledge of DNA and RNA has expanded, so scientists are trying to explain the evolution through the genetic mutation. But there also, in genetic mutation theory also, there are some drawbacks. What is the drawback? We see that by genetic mutation, one species transforms into same species, same variety of the species. You don't see a cat transforming into a dog, a monkey into some other animal, no. By genetic mutation, dog can become another breed of dog, but not another species. So that also fails. And Darwin tried to give mechanism of evolution by his own speculation based on material outlook, because he didn't have any knowledge of soul. It is a fact that Vedas talk of evolution, but not of the body, but of the spirit soul. Vedas also talk of evolution, but the soul evolves from one body to another body. It is not that the body evolves, the soul is evolving. That's what they say. Vedas say that soul who is residing in one body moves at the time of death to another body. not that one body changes to another. One may say, okay, sir, what is the problem with making mistakes? It's a small problem. Anybody makes this problem, mistakes. Small some mistakes do happen. But then the question is, yes, mistakes do happen, but the consequences are very tremendous, very hazardous. Like, for example, nowadays we are all using gadgets. These gadgets are very nice to use. These are the gifts of technology. But there are also some problems coming with this technology. And can you mention some of the problems with these technologies? What problems these technologies are causing?
Addiction.
Addiction.
Addiction, yeah. People are sitting with their mobiles, playing games, PUBG and other things all night. Health issues, correct? Right? We get health problems. Nowadays, I heard that 5G is going to come, that 5G is very disastrous. The birds are dying. The birds cannot withstand this 5G. So much radiation in the atmosphere is very dangerous. Addiction to social media, correct? Sleeplessness, computer vision syndrome, depression, attention deficiency, hyperactivity disorder. That's called depression. Hearing damage, obesity, you know, because people are getting tension, they become big, fat, obesity, right? And loss of relationships, no meaningful relationships. In Silicon Valley, there is one Theranos lab. There they claim that using one blood drop, they can test, they can diagnose, and they can give the result. So they automated this everything. But later on, the big fraud, big mistake was found in that. And so many lives were lost because of this. And bubonic plague, which came in Europe many centuries back. So they found out, they thought that the cause of this plague is cats. So they told you kill all the cats. And after they killed all the cats, they realized that the cause is rats, not the cats. Now to catch the rats, there are no cats. So one small mistake, they had to pay a heavy price. So it actually killed a big part of Europe in 13th century. That's a half knowledge is dangerous thing. Now, can you think of one incident, one case study, where solution to one problem became a bigger problem? A scientific solution to one problem became a bigger problem. Can you think of any such thing? Yes, people are thinking. Solution to one problem is a bigger problem.
Corona.
Yes. Rakesh, we cannot hear you.
Corona.
Corona. Okay, what is the solution? What is the problem?
Corona emerged in China because of some lab in Wuhan.
Research, you can say. Okay. Some say that they explain saying that they did some research in China lab and then it leaked and it's causing trouble everywhere now. Yeah, so we can say, of course, that there's still doubt whether it's true or false, but assuming that it can be one of the probable cases. Yeah, it is true. Solution to one problem is a bigger problem. Medications, Vaishnavi is telling. So immunity is side effects, right? It is a solution to a problem, but it causes side effects. Like if you take some heavy antibiotics, it has side effects. If you take paracetamol, it is written in paracetamol. Paracetamol can damage your liver. Please take under medical consultation. Factories. Yes, factories are manufacturing cars. Because we wanted to avoid walking, the trouble of walking. But then we made cars, and the cars are causing pollution. And there's so much traffic jam that we cannot even go fast. We go so slowly. Yes, factories are true. So, Pratyaksha and Anumana, cannot give us complete knowledge. So is there any other way? Right? So is there any other way to come get the complete knowledge of complete happiness? I'll show you a video, a very nice video. You can watch it. And then we'll discuss based on that. What can we learn from this story of this person? Interesting, funny video. Okay, Purna Shri is telling that he is experimenting. He doesn't know what which button is for what. He is experimenting. He gets into trouble. Correct. Any other comments? Okay, we must know how to use it. Correct. Yashwant is telling. Correct. What you should have done? Before operating the machine, what you should have done?
Read the instructions.
You should have run the instruction, read the instruction manual. Padmanabh is also telling. Before full knowledge, we should not start trying anything. Yeah, we should get trained. So you should have read the manual, which button is for what. Like for learning driving, you go to the driving school, you know, okay, what is clutch, A, B, C. Then accelerator, then put the gear, and all those things is there. So you have to read the manual, which can explain the operating procedure. So where is the manual that can explain operation of this cosmic machine? If you can get it, then we have the key to happiness. Okay, what is that manual? Just see, my dear friend, how four defects keep us blind to the truth. Is there no other way? Other than Pratyaksha or Anumana, to know the complete knowledge that is free from all danger. That's called Shabda Pramana, hearing from bona fide authority. Evam parampara praptam imam rajarsho viduhu sakaleni hamahata yogunashta parantapaha. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that this knowledge of Vedas is coming from time immemorial through the line of disciplic succession through Rajarishis. So that's called Shabda Pramana, the knowledge coming directly from God. For example, if a child wants to know who his father is, okay, this child doesn't know who his father is. There are two ways of knowing who his father is. One is, okay, go to the doctor and give your gene. And then the doctor can identify some probable candidates. Maybe you are born in this Bangalore area, in this place. Okay, you can take all the samples of the men and then check, compare. So the genetic fingerprinting takes 800 years to identify a lot of 200 men, one of whom is likely to be your father. It takes so much time and money. Okay. So it's called inductive knowledge, trying to get knowledge by induction or research. Is there any other method? Yes, there is another method. Just ask your mother, who is your father? Okay, mama, who is my father? The mother will say, this is your father. His mother is the authority. She knows. When you're born, your connection is only with the mother. Only when mother says, Papa, this is your papa, then we accept that he is our papa. Okay. So this is called deductive knowledge. This saves time and this is foolproof method of understanding the truth. Similarly, Vedas are the mother. God is your supreme father. Vedas can give us GK, God knowledge. and not just general knowledge. They give a lot of general knowledge, but I don't know whether they give God knowledge also.
The Vedas.
The Vedas contain a lot of mantras. See this video.
The Vedas, however, are not as well known for presenting historical and scientific knowledge as they are for expounding subtle sciences such as the power of mantras. We all recognize the power of sound itself by its effects, which can be quite dramatic. Here, a high-pitched frequency shatters a drinking glass. So, we can easily understand that loud sounds can produce substantial reactions. It is commonly believed that mantras can carry hidden power, which can in turn produce profound effects. The ancient Vedic literatures are full of descriptions of weapons being called by mantra. For example, many weapons were invoked by mantra during the epic Kurukshetra War, wherein the Bhagavad Gita itself was spoken. The ancient deployment of Brahmastra weapons, equivalent to modern-day nuclear weapons, are described throughout the Vedic literatures. Additionally, mantras carry hidden spiritual power, which can produce significant benefits when chanted properly. Indeed, the Vedas themselves are sound vibrations in literary form and carry a profound message.
So Shabda means sound, and Vedas are also called Shruti. Shruti means sound which is heard through the ears. So Vedas are the authority which can tell us clearly about God. A Vedic process of learning is similar to what we do in the college. No? When you go to study, we go to authorized college, which is called Parampara or Sampradaya. In the authorized college, there are teachers who are also authorized. Right? Anybody cannot be a teacher. They also must have a certificate. So they are called for teaching. And we choose the college based on its accreditation. It should be accredited by AICTE or Indian Medical or Medical Associations. It should be accredited. Then only we can accept that college. And there are bona fide books, right? Reference books. So text, Vedic texts like Bhagavad Gita. So these three should be there: Parampara, Guru, and Scripture, Vedas. So in the knowledge, in the Vedas, advanced knowledge is also given. Like for example, Vimana Shastra.
University of California at Irvine, April 2017. Aerospace engineer Travis Taylor has obtained a model of an aircraft whose design specifications are based solely on information gleaned from ancient Indian texts that are believed to have been formally set to writing in 500 BC. He is going to subject it to wind tunnel analysis to determine if it is a viable flying machine. The aircraft model created using details garnered from the ancient University of California. Okay.
So basically he is making a model of the aircraft based on the details given in Vimana Shastra, right? You hear of Pushpak Vimana, you hear of Gandharvas traveling in aeroplanes. So knowledge of Vedas or Vimanas is there in Shastra. And now people are researching. I heard that many of the German universities are studying Sanskrit and researching on this. That's why they have high capacity automobiles, high performance automobiles there. There are many predictions. Like Gautam Buddha is predicted in Srimad Bhagavatam. Chanakya is predicted in Bhagavatam 12th Canto. Ashoka is predicted in Bhagavatam 12th Canto. Jesus Christ, Prophet Muhammad are predicted in Bhavishya Purana, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Mahabharata. So before the event happened, they are predicted.
The Vedas are amongst the oldest religious scriptures known to mankind and are the source of India's spiritual and cultural heritage. At first glance, the multifaceted culture of the Vedas is a foreign and fascinating mystery to the Western eye. Yet upon deeper examination, we discover a wealth of philosophical, cultural, and social values. India is renowned the world over for the practice of yoga, which increases one's mental and physical strength. However, this is only a fraction of what the Vedas can offer to a progressive global community. India's culinary arts, music, natural medicine, and other sciences are only now becoming known to the West. Conceivably the world's oldest holistic design system, the Vastu Shastra predates and inspired the popular Chinese system of Feng Shui. The design of a temple, house, or workspace has been proven to exert a considerable influence on one's well-being. The Vastu Shastra was compiled specifically to address this concern and offers practical architectural guidelines. This style of sacred architecture has been implemented in the building of India's largest temples for thousands of years. The sculptures adorning these temples reflect the development and accomplishments of one of man's oldest civilizations. They depict the struggles, failures, and successes of the men who made them the center of their lives. The sophisticated Vedic sciences of astrology, astronomy, cosmology, and metaphysics profoundly influenced the Greeks, Babylonians, and even contemporary scientists with their unparalleled knowledge. Ancient Vedic sages presented precise calculations a millennium before Copernicus, Galileo, Newton, and Einstein.
So advanced knowledge is there in Vedas also. Then how were the Indians diverted from putting faith in Vedas? There were a group of Westerners, Macaulay and Max Muller, who came and who studied Vedas, and they misinterpreted Vedas as if to make us feel that they're all imaginary fiction. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, this theory of Aryan invasion theory, which says that Europeans are the original Aryans and they came to India and they settled. So this is the one theory which they used to conquer India. But later it is proven that Aryan invasion theory is false. It's fake.
Aloha and namaste. 2020 is certainly a year that will not soon be forgotten. For most, if not all of us, it has brought about many unexpected changes. The uncertainty that this year has brought has made me personally reflect upon the time that I spent deployed in the Middle East. That too was a time in my life when there was danger at every step. Each day brought new uncertainties and likewise, many lives were lost. My shelter then and now has been the Bhagavad Gita, which means song of God. The Bhagavad Gita spoken by Sri Krishna is full of transcendental wisdom that is as relevant today as it was 5,000 years ago when it was spoken. When we are blown here and there by the strong winds of change, when giant waves are crashing upon us, when we're feeling unsteady, lost, adrift, the Bhagavad Gita offers us guidance and hope. Looking at our problems through the prism of eternality, rather than merely identifying with our temporary material circumstances, gives us an anchor that offers great peace, purpose, and stability through even the most trying of times. May we always be blessed with remembrance of Sri Krishna, his unconditional love, and his transcendental appearance in this world. Jaya Sri Krishna.
So she is one of the congresswomen in America, Tulsi Gabbard. She's originally from Indian roots. You know, she is one of the politicians there. See, just like in science, there are axioms. Vedas also have axioms. No? Like I is equal to root of minus 1 is an axiom. Heisenberg uncertainty principle, we have to accept it. No? a particle cannot, you cannot measure the position and the velocity, right, of a particle. Law of thermodynamics, nobody has seen zero entropy, zero Kelvin, but still we accept. So like there are many axioms. So even in science and Vedas also there are axioms. And this knowledge is coming by parampara. There are four sampradayas from which the knowledge is coming. Lord Krishna gave knowledge to Lakshmi, to Brahma, to Rudra, and to Kumaras, Chatush Kumaras. And they started four institutions, four paramparas. So the leader of Sri Sampradaya is Ramanujacharya. Brahma Sampradaya is Madhvacharya. So we ISKCON. ISKCON comes under Madhva Sampradaya, Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya. So whatever we are teaching here from Bhagavad Gita is coming from this Sampradaya. Rudra Sampradaya, where Vishnu Swami is a prominent Acharya. Kumar Sampradaya, where Nimbarka Swami is a prominent Acharya. Okay. So Tene Brahma Hridaya Adikave, Lord Krishna gave knowledge to Brahma in the beginning of creation. And Brahma gave it to Narada. Narada to his disciple succession, Vyasa. Vyasa to Madhva. It comes down.
We haven't got to manufacture something. We simply repeat the words and the instruction given by the predecessor. Krishna instructed Brahma. Brahma instructed Narada. Narada instructed Vyasadeva. Vyasadeva instructed Madhyacharya. And in this way, then Madhavendra Puri, Ishwar Puri, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then the six Goswamis, then the Srinivasa Acharya, Kaviraj Goswami, Narottam Das Thakur, Vishwanath Chakravarti, Jagannath Das Babaji, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Gaurkishore Das Babaji, Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, and then we are doing the same thing. There is no difference. That is the specific procedure of the Krishna Consciousness Movement.
So there's a Guru Parampara of ISKCON. So Srila Prabhupada is the founder of ISKCON and is coming in this line of disciple succession. So Vedas were never written, but they were heard and transmitted. But 5,000 years back, in the beginning of Kali Yuga, Vyasadeva put it in writing because he understood that people in Kali Yuga are having short memory. Previously, they are Shrutidhar. They will hear once and remember eternally. But in Kali Yuga, it is different. So he wrote down. And these are the Vedic tree, huge Vedic tree. So there is Shruti and Smriti. Shruti means four Vedas, Rig, Yajur, Atharva, Sama, Atharva, Upavedas, Dhanurveda, Ayurveda, Adi, etc. And then Vedanga. And Smriti contains Anushthana Sutra, Tantra, Pancharatra, Purana, which has 18 Pramukha Puranas, 18 Lahu Puranas. Itihasas include Ramayana, Mahabharata, and Shad Darshanas. Vedanta, Mimamsa, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Yoga, and Sankhya. So this is the Vedic tree. Huge. Vedas contain 1 lakh into 1 lakh shlokas. And we are getting this Vedic knowledge from Srila Prabhupada, the founder of ISKCON. So how these six blind men can understand this creature? When a person in knowledge, he comes and says, this is an elephant. Then six blind men can get complete knowledge. Similarly, when we are searching for God, when we get knowledge through Vedas, then we can understand, hey, this is God, without any doubt. So a person who has heard the Vedas, who knows the knowledge of Vedas, he should tell us. So we get part truth from our experiment, but when you hear from a person who knows the truth, we get full knowledge. So with this, we end this session. So we learned about three ways of gaining knowledge: Pratyaksha, Anumana, and Shabda Praman. And Pratyaksha Praman, we have four defects, so Pratyaksha Praman cannot give us complete knowledge. Four defects are imperfect senses, tendency to get illusion, committing mistakes, cheating propensity. Anuman Praman, mistakes in science causes disaster, half knowledge is dangerous. We discussed about Darwin theory also. Shabda Praman, so it is deductive knowledge, which is better than inductive knowledge. Vedic truths and predictions, four sampradayas and branches of Vedas. And this is the flowchart of the entire this thing. Okay. So we will end with this. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Okay, so now if anybody has any questions regarding today's session, there are questions pertaining to everything, but if it's related to today's session, we can say. Okay. Yeah, any questions? Anybody else? Okay, so there's a question coming in the chat box. Where can we buy the original Vedas? See, original Vedas are available. There are many people who are preserving them. Original Vedas, when I don't mean that original paper on which it is written or the leaf on which it is written, because you cannot preserve them. It's 5,000 years old scripts. How can you preserve them? So they were copied by Guru. Guru gave it to Shishya, Shishya gave it to his Shishya, and then it went on like that. So it's coming like that. So that knowledge is there. It is Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, the important Puranas, the four Vedas, they're available. But some of the knowledge is lost. We have to accept it. Because when the Muslims attacked India, at that time they attacked the Gurukuls, they attacked the places of learning like Nalanda, Takshashila, and they burned volumes of books. They burned so many books that those are not available now. But whatever is required, the essential books are still available. So you can find them in libraries. I heard in Chennai there's a library where they are preserving. In Pune there is a Sanskrit library where they are preserving the scripture. In ISKCON, ISKCON also has a library in Calcutta. It's called Bhaktivedanta Research Center, BRC. So there also they are trying to preserve all the Acharya's writings. Yeah. So brief information about four Vedas. Yeah, I can try to tell it tomorrow. I need to refer some books for that. I can share it tomorrow. Yashwant is telling, as far as we know, Krishna educated Gita to Arjuna. But in the flowchart, we can't see Arjuna. See, Arjuna was one of the disciples of Krishna. But Krishna gave knowledge to Brahma long back also. Okay. So Krishna spoke only Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna. So which is the essence of all the Vedas. Sarvopanishado gavo dugdha gopalanandana partho vatsa sudhirbhokta dugdham gitamritam mahat. So the essence of all the Vedas is Bhagavad Gita. So if you compare the body of a cow to the Vedas, the milk is Bhagavad Gita. So if you know the essence, which is Bhagavad Gita, you know everything. Right? So the essence is available, so we can know the essence. So the essence was taught to Arjuna, and we are getting this Bhagavad Gita. So we read Bhagavad Gita by Srila Prabhupada, he has written it. By reading that, and Bhagavad Gita is part of Mahabharata. Mahabharata is part of the Itihasas. It's also part of Veda. It's called Panchama Veda. There are four Vedas. So Mahabharata, Ramayana considered to be Puranas. Purana, Mahabharata, Ramayana considered to be Panchama Veda. So Arjuna is there. But the main four sampradayas which Krishna established are Shri, Brahma, Rudra, Sanatana. Gaurav, why Srila Prabhupada did not write Vedas in detail as he did for Srimad Bhagavatam? See, Prabhupada had a desire, lot of desire. He wanted to write Bhagavad Gita, he wanted to write Bhagavatam, he wanted to write Nectar of Devotion, Nectar of Instruction, he wanted to translate Mahabharata also, he wanted to translate Ramayana also, but time was less. So Prabhupada had desire to do all that, but one man, how much he can do? So he took the main books first, no? Gita he took first, then Bhagavatam he took. And Chaitanya Charitamrita and the Nectar of Devotion, Nectar of Instruction. So it was a very, very Ishopanishad. Few books he took, and already he was 80 years old. So he left the planet when he was about around 80 years old. So even Bhagavatam also he completed to 10th canto. But then he told his disciples, no, you can do, you can continue translating in English. So Prabhupada gave the most important book, Bhagavad Gita to us and Bhagavatam to us. So that is sufficient. Okay, first we should read these two. And then if time permits, we can read other books. Srinivas is asking an important question. Why Indian system doesn't teach Gita? Okay. It should be teaching, and Gita should become the national book. Like you have national anthem, national, national game, national animal. It should become the national book. National book. Everybody should read. I don't know why, because of the education system is like that, or people are fearful of religion, people are not accepting Gita. Of course, some of them do teach Gita. Today only one of my brahmachari friends was telling that they invited into one school. In college, online seminar, about 200 students participated in Bhagavad Gita class, which was 3 days. So today is the first day. Some schools are inviting. Now they are realizing the importance. So every school and college should promote it. But because of, in the name of secularism, they are becoming atheists. So we should teach. Probably if this Vedic knowledge was so beneficial, then why Jains and Buddhists went against it? Yeah. See, Buddhism, how it started with Gautam Buddha, Siddhartha. So when Krishna came 5,000 years back, he established Vedas very strongly. But after 2,500 years, people started misusing the Vedas. And they were doing lot of animal slaughter. Like in Vedas, some sacrifices are mentioned where you can offer Bali. That is mentioned only for a class of people who cannot give up eating meat. For them, it is mentioned, okay, if you want to eat, then do it with those rules and regulations. And those rules and regulations are so strict that eventually they'll get fed up and they'll stop eating meat. But these people, around 500 BC, 2,500 years back, they started unrestricted animal killing and they started eating meat. So Buddha came and said, stop all this. You're misusing the Vedas. Right? You're misusing the Vedas for your own benefit. So stop doing this. And he said, follow Ahimsa Paramo Dharma. Follow just Ahimsa. Don't read Vedas. So that's the reason why Buddha stopped reading Vedas. It doesn't mean that Vedas are wrong. It means that people at the time were not fit to understand Vedas. That's why he said, you stop it. Right? So for example, if a person by studying technology, he's making missiles for terrorism, you will say, okay, stop education, because you're misusing your education. So like that, Buddha said, don't stop reading these Vedas. Better you follow Ahimsa. So that was the reason. But later on, Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya, Ramanacharya, they came and established the Vedas, and now people are again accepting Vedas. Nirali is asking, why ain't Vedic knowledge given in Indian schools? Why aren't we taught more about God and royal in Indian culture and Vedas? See, one reason is because the education system was, see, current education system we are studying is British education system. It is not Indian education system. In British education system, they made the syllabus in such a way that you will read French Revolution, British Revolution, American Revolution, and all those things. You will read more about Mughal kings. You will read more about other religions, more rather than our own religion, our own famous kings, like Yudhishthira, Pandavas. You don't read Mahabharata, Ramayana much. Some small here and there, some mentions may be there. Because the education system was designed by the British. And even after independence, people who continued the education system were also affected with British. So they failed to bring these books, Vedic books, in the college and school. So that's why it is like that. So that's why ISKCON, Prabhupada said, should be like a university where you teach about God to everyone. So that which is lacking in schools, we are supplementing. Right? Okay, you study material science there, but you study about God from here. So we are supplementing. So we go to many schools and colleges and do value education. We teach about God, we teach Bhagavad Gita. So we are supplementing their education. It's not in syllabus, but we supplement it. And eventually we dream for a day wherein Gita will be part of the syllabus. That's good. As far as Ayurveda is concerned, it's called Panchamveda. Is it not true? I have not heard that. It's part of, I guess, if I'm not wrong, it's part of one of the four Vedas. I need to confirm. It's part of one of the four Vedas. Okay. We can let you know which Veda it's part of. Shirin was asking, Guruji, I am final year of engineering. Frankly telling, I'm feeling like I've wasted my 16 years of education. How can we make a change in our life by this knowledge? Srinivas feeling in one sense, when you see that you're studying only about matter, but not about soul, not about the reality of life, we feel like that. But what you can do, whatever you have learned engineering till now, you can use it to glorify God. So that's what we can do. You have studied whatever department, you can use that degree. Okay, you are a B.Tech or M.Tech, then you can use that degree to spread the knowledge of God. You can use that credibility to glorify God. Because when a person has learned engineering, then he speaks about God, then people think, "Are itna padhai karke bhagwan ke bare mein bol raha hai." If a medical doctor, he says about God with all proofs and evidences from science and medical science, then people will listen to him. So you can use the same knowledge to glorify God. So in that sense, you will not feel that it's waste. You'll be able to utilize it in Lord's service. Material science is also there in Vedas, but material science should be connected with God. But in modern science, what is happening? It is disconnected from God. So what we should do, devotees should do, we should connect that material science in service of the God. Is there any Bhagavad Gita courses to explain in detail about Bhagavad Gita? Since I have also started reading Bhagavad Gita to understand it in detail, is there any such? Yes, we have. In fact, very soon we may launch a course on Bhagavad Gita in June. But if you want, already I have done one course on 18 chapters of Gita. 18 chapters, it is already there. Srikar Prabhu can share that link. Srikar Prabhu is here. So maybe I can share that link in the WhatsApp group. 18 chapters in 18 days we have done. So we'll get a brief overview of each session is about 1.5 hours with question answers. So you can go through that. We'll get an understanding of Gita. Then when you read Gita, you'll understand it much better. Prabhuji, does ISKCON Gurukul teach Vedas? What is the syllabus flow there? Yeah, they teach Vedas. They teach basics of some of the Vedas, not all the Vedas. Okay, so there are different kinds of studies and different kinds of Gurukuls. Again, some mathas, like you go to Sringeri Gurukul, so they will teach one Veda and you have to choose which Veda you are going to study, and that will take you 12 years. Okay, so first initial 6 years of Sanskrit, and then again 6 years of one Vedic study, either Yajurveda or Atharvaveda, like that. Then you'll become Yajurvedi or Atharvavedi, like that. So that is one way of studying. But in ISKCON Gurukul, Mayapur, they have a little different approach. So they teach Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, they teach Panchatantras, they teach each Upanishad, they teach Vedic mantras, they teach how to do yajnas. They also teach martial arts, cooking, they teach agriculture, they teach horse riding, they teach doing archana, yajnas, so many things they teach. So it's all part of their syllabus. Exact details, if you want to know, then you can contact the Mayapur principal there. So then they'll tell you more details. Yeah. How to read Bhagavad Gita efficiently? Yashwanti Chan is part of Atharvaveda. Yeah, I think so. Yeah. How to read Bhagavad Gita efficiently? So, one way to read Bhagavad Gita efficiently is one can learn from somebody who has read it before. Like we have Bhagavad Gita 6-day course. Like we have this discourse, of course, say 8 days. After this, you get some basics of Bhagavad Gita. Then you can go through chapter-wise study of Bhagavad Gita. So which link we will send you. So once you go through that, you will get the whole summary of the Gita. Then you can take this Gita from ISKCON's Bhagavad Gita is there, written by Srila Prabhupada. So it has got shlokas, translation and purports. Shloka, translation, purports for every shloka. So by reading these purports, you will understand in depth about Bhagavad Gita. Okay, so that's what we do. And later on in ISKCON, we have a course called Bhakti Shastri, where is an intensive course where shloka by shloka study of Gita, along with some Acharya's purports, we study. Right. So in ISKCON, we have courses like Bhakti Shastri, Bhakti Vaibhav, Bhakti Vedanta, Bhakti Sarabham. So all these things we do. So that's one way. So first you hear chapter wise at 18 chapters course, and then you read the purports, and then you can undergo Bhakti Shastri course later on. So that will give a thorough understanding of Gita. You have to read it again and again. I have read Gita about 10-15 times. So it gives deeper and deeper understanding. So there's somebody asking, what about you? What you have learned, Guruji? See, I have studied Bhagavad Gita, Ishopanishad, Bhaktir Samabrata Sindhu, and then Nectar of Instruction, Srimad Bhagavatam, Mahabharata, Ramayana. So I have done, there are courses in ISKCON called Bhakti Shastri. So I have completed that course. I have done Bhakti Vaibhava, which is Srimad Bhagavatam course for first 6 cantos. And now I'm undergoing Bhakti Vedanta course. So I'm in process of that. So we are learning all these courses. In ISKCON, we have systematic teaching methodologies. So we have many, many courses. So we go through that. And while going through that, we also teach. We teach others what we have learned. Yeah. Can you also share information on joining martial arts in ISKCON? In ISKCON, only in Mayapur Gurukul that is taught martial arts and nowhere else. So the scope is less in ISKCON. Yeah. But there are many others teaching martial arts. Like Kalaripattai, they teach in Kerala. In Bangalore also, there are many teachers teaching that. So you can join those people. So it is said that the Kalaripattai, which is in Kerala, that is the root, origin of all the martial arts. So, you know, from here only, the martial arts went to China and Japan. And China and Japan people took it and they've taken it to a height. It all originated from here. Does ISKCON Gurukul allow 20 plus students to join? Oh, you're too old. Generally, they join there at the age of 7, 8, 10. So by the age of 16 or 18, they are graduated. So 20 plus is too late age to join the Gurukul. At a very young age, they join 7, 8 or 10. Okay. 20 years is too late. Yes, Rakesh is asking. I was not able to hear you. I'm telling that martial arts, only in ISKCON Mayapur it is taught for children. But because you're old, you're elderly, means elderly in the sense you're 20 plus, you can join some martial arts training in Kerala, like Kalaripattai. So they can teach nicely because all the martial arts originated from this Kalaripattai, which is in Kerala, which is originally taught and practiced in Kerala. Still, there are some schools, so they'll be able to teach you better. Bhakti Shastri course, is it available online? Yes, it is available online. Yes, it is available. There is live classes are available. I am myself taking for a batch in Bangalore for our temple. About 50 people are attending every week. So, but there's mainly for devotees chanting 16 rounds of Hare Krishna. There are some criteria. So maybe after a year, you can contact us. So then you can attend. There are some criteria. It's only for those who are very seriously practicing chanting Hare Krishna, following all the 4 yield principles. So they are eligible for attending that. Okay. Okay. I think questions are over. Now, tomorrow's topic is this. Discover lasting solutions. Put a full stop to all sufferings. So, you know, so much disease and pandemic is spreading. So many sufferings are there in this world. So is there any way to put a full stop to all the sufferings? And what is that solution? So that we'll try to discuss tomorrow, 7 o'clock. Okay. Hare Krishna. So tomorrow also is a very auspicious day. It is Narasimha Chaturdasi. So the day when Lord Narasimha appeared to protect Prahlad and kill Hiranyakashipu. So very auspicious day. So let's join tomorrow 7 p.m. and do this session. Okay. Thank you so much for being with us. Hare Krishna.